In this problem, we're going to consider a system of multiple reactions. And this is a two-part problem. And the first, we're going to set up the problem and talk about what variables we'll need to know to deal with this system of multiple reactions that are exothermic reactions. That exothermicity needs to be explicitly taken into account. And then in the second part of the problem, we'll show the setup of a numerical simulation in order to try to optimize the performance of the reactor. And we'll see that optimization is actually a very difficult process. But first, to just set up the problem, and that means setting up balances. And in this case, we're going to ignore pressure drop for this problem, but we will not assume isothermal operation. And so we will need to set up both an energy balance and then material balances for all our reactants and products. Right. And so the reaction network is given here. It's actually based on a real example of ethylene epoxidation, where A is ethylene, B is oxygen, C is ethylene oxide, and D and E are carbon dioxide and water. And so D and E are not very valuable products, but C is. And so you'd like to optimize the amount of C that you form. You'd like to form it at a high rate, but still achieve high selectivity to C. And what makes this especially difficult, as we'll see, is that the desired reaction is slightly exothermic, but the complete combustion to form CO2 and water is highly exothermic. It will tend to release heat, and the reaction will end up feeding on itself. The reaction is going to be conducted in a packed bed reactor with an assumption of minimal pressure drop in this case. As in the true case of ethylene epoxidation, the reactor is actually a shell and tube kind of configuration where we have a tubular reactor with a packed bed of catalyst, and we will have flow through this reactor, and then we're going to have a cooling fluid, entering cooling fluid temperature, that will be water, let's say, and that will be flowing on the outside of the tubes to try to cool off the reaction to remove the heat that's generated from the exotherm of the reactions. And so we'll need to write an energy balance that incorporates this. Okay, but first we'll start off by writing the material balances, and again, we're going to do that for each component. Right? And we're going to write these rather than in terms of conversion, we'll write it in terms of molar flow rates, because this is a system of multiple reactions. And as we've seen, that usually makes it advantageous to work in terms of moles. All right, so let's write it first for component A. And so we can write that DFA DW, because this is a packed bed reactor, is equal to the net rate of formation is equal to the net rate of formation of A through reaction 1 plus the net rate of formation of A through reaction 2. And we see, of course, that these are going to be negative quantities, and so FA is going to decrease with respect to time. And then we're going to need to know the initial condition for this. It's not specified in this problem. We'll specify it at a later point. But I'll just note that in order to solve the problem, we're going to need to know what our inlet flow rate of A is. Okay, we can likewise write a balance for B, for example. B is consumed at half the rate of A in reaction 1. B is consumed at 3 times the rate of A in reaction 2. And B is consumed at 5/2 times the rate at which C is consumed. And see, we're tracking the reaction rate of C here in this experimental expression. And there's actually a typo here. I should correct this. This depends on the concentration of C, not the concentration of A, because A is not involved in that reaction. We will need a 5/2 times the rate of net accumulation of C. Right, and again, these are all negative numbers once we take into account the negative signs here. And so oxygen, as we know, or component B, is being consumed in this reaction. And so we expect it to be a negative number. And again, I won't bother to write this every time, but we'll also need the initial flow rate of oxygen in order to solve this material balance. All right, we'll go ahead and write a couple of more balances. I'll go ahead and just try to do them in the margins here. So C, we can write a balance on, and it is formed through the reaction of A. Okay, in a 1-to-1 stoichiometry, so 1 mole of A makes 1 mole of C. And then it is consumed in reaction 3. And this is given in terms of the rate of consumption of C. Okay, and it's not formed in reaction 2. And then finally, we can write the balances for D and E, which are equivalent. Every time you make a mole of D, you also make a mole of E in each of these equations. And they're formed in reactions 2 and 3. And so I'll go ahead and write that out here. And in fact, FD is always equal to FE. And this is equal to the rate of 2 times the rate of consumption of A through reaction one. I want a negative sign here so that the number increases. And then 5/2 times the rate of reaction of C through reaction three. I'm sorry, this should be reaction A, two. Okay, and both of those will be positive numbers and will tend to accumulate D and E with respect to going down the reactor. Okay, these are all our material balances. The next thing that we will need to know are the rates of reaction expressed, in this case, in terms of concentration. Those are given here. We know the reaction order dependences. They're all half order in one of the reactants and first order in the other. They have different rate constants associated with them. We're going to need to know the values of those rate constants, of course. And then more importantly, we're actually going to need to know how those rate constants vary with temperature. So we're going to need to know K as a function of temperature, since this is not an isothermal, necessarily an isothermal reaction, because there's a large exotherm in this case. And so we're going to have to take into account the fact that the temperature can vary down the length of the reactor, and that can have a corresponding effect on the rate of reaction, as we'll see in the next part of this problem. Okay, so we'll need those values of K and need their corresponding activation energies and pre-exponential factors. And then the other thing we're going to need to do is express concentrations in terms of molar flow rates. And so I won't write this out for each one because it's the same in every case. But this means that for any component I, we can write the concentration as being the molar flow rate of that component I so that we can connect it to our material balances divided by the initial volumetric flow rate. But of course, the initial volumetric flow rate can potentially change as we go down the reactor because we can have a change in temperature and a change in the number of moles. And those terms will cause us to put... And so just from the ideal gas law, we have this kind of relationship, this kind of variation of the volumetric flow rate, which can change as a function of the molar flow rates and the temperature. And again, the pressure is assumed to be constant in this case, so we don't have a P over P naught term. And so we just write one of these expressions for each of our concentration variables A through E. And you'll see we'll need to know things like the inlet volumetric flow rate. We'll need to know the initial molar flow rates of each of our components, the initial temperature. And then, of course, if we know the initial flow rates of each of our individual species, we can sum them up to get the total flow rate. So I'll write this expression up here, but Ft is just the sum of Fti. Okay, so those are all the material balances that we need. And if this was an isothermal reaction and we had all the variables that we talked about, then we go ahead and solve the material balance for that isothermal case. But now we need an energy balance because this is not an isothermal reaction. I've just copied in the correct form of the energy balance relation. I just wanted to talk about the individual terms in this kind of relationship. And so here we're writing the relationship for a packed bed reactor. So we want to keep track of how the temperature changes as reactants see an increasing mass of catalyst, so dT dW. And if the temperature is going up, of course, we're going to expect the quantity to be positive. If it's going down, we're going to expect it to be negative, and it would be near zero for an approximately isothermal reaction. Right, let's look at some of the components of this expression. Okay, one of the components has to do with the exotherm of the reaction, and that's the term that's in parentheses here. And this term, we simply multiply the rate of reaction of one component in each reaction. So you see we have three expressions here, three rates of reaction. This corresponds to the consumption of component one and the desired reaction. And so we need to use the heat of reaction here that we're going to, that's a variable we need that we might need to, for example, compute from the enthalpies of formation of the products minus the reactants. We need to do that in such a way that this is given per mole of A. So it will be in units of this problem, we'll see eventually, of energy per moles of a component, and in this case it's moles of A because we're defining the reaction rate in terms of moles of A. Right, same thing here, we're defining reaction rate in terms of moles of A, so we need to look up the heat of reaction in terms of moles of A or compute that per mole of A and not, for example, per mole of oxygen when we computed the heat of reaction. And the same thing for component C. And that way our units will cancel out correctly because what essentially this tells us is the moles of A that are consumed per mass of catalyst per time. And so when you multiply those together, we'll get an energy per time term. The units ultimately cancel out in the next example. One useful thing to do here, the signs can get very confusing, and so it's useful to do a sanity check. Okay, and so these are all exothermic reactions. That means that all of the heats of reaction should be negative. All of these rates, if we look at the previous page, correspond to consumption of that component. And so as defined, they're also going to be negative numbers. And so this is going to be a positive term that makes dT dW increase. Right? And that makes sense. We expect that the temperature will tend to go up as the exothermicity of the reaction becomes more important. Usually to avoid getting confused about the signs, it's useful to do that sanity check to make sure that each term is bringing the temperature in the direction that you would expect. Okay, so that's the term associated with the reaction. Let's next move to this term in the denominator. This term has to do with the ability of the stream that's flowing through the reactor to absorb the heat that is being generated in the exothermic reaction, and as we'll see, being removed from heat transfer in the other term that's in the numerator. Okay, and here this is a fairly simple term. We just need to know the heat capacity of each component in our mixture, and we multiply that by the molar flow rate, and that gives us the convective heat transfer term that tells us how effectively heat can be absorbed or released by the fluid that's flowing through the reactor. And so we're going to need, in addition to the heats of reaction that we're going to need to have available for us, we're going to need heat capacities for each of our individual reactants. Okay, the final term is this heat transfer term that comes about from the fact that we have a cooling fluid, we have cooling water on the shell side of our tube and shell reactor geometry. We're going to expect this to have a net decreasing effect on the temperature, right? And in this case, actually, I need to change a sign here, so it's good that I caught this. So this should be a negative sign. All right, so all of these quantities, as we'll see, are positive. They're constants associated with the heat exchanger itself. The T is the temperature inside the reactor. It is greater than the temperature of the cooling water, so this is a positive number. But we know that the effect of the cooling is to bring the temperature down, and so we expect an overall negative term. And so we know that the sign here has to be negative. Okay, so we see that this should be a negative quantity. What are these different terms? So the U is the overall heat transfer coefficient. In many of the problems that you'll see in your textbook, there will probably be a term that's just given, but it's a term that you learn how to calculate in heat transfer class from summing the individual resistance to heat transfer on the tube, wall, and shell sides. Density is just the catalyst density, and that needs to be in there because of this term, basically. And we are going to go through the detailed derivation of this term. We'll just talk about what it is. This term is basically the amount of surface area you have per volume of catalyst. And then when you divide that by the density, that gives you the kilograms per volume of catalyst. And so that cancels. And you end up getting the surface area that you have available for heat transfer divided by the kilograms of catalyst, which is what you need in order to determine dTdW. Okay, and so this surface area per volume, typically we would use a tubular geometry. So for the surface area of a tubular type geometry, the surface area would be the height times the circumference of the cylinder. Right, so it would be pi d for the circumference times the length, and the volume of the reactor would be, again, the length, and then in this case times the area of the circle. Okay, so if you know the geometry of your reactor, and that's actually something else that you can optimize, then you can determine the value of A. And in many cases, you'll see that it's just given for a particular problem. Again, the temperature is something that we're solving for. It's the temperature inside the reactor. The TA is actually also something that we can potentially solve for. We can assume that TA is uniform throughout the cooling fluid, or if you really have a true co-current flow, you actually need to write a material balance for that component. And to do that, you get a simpler form. We'll go ahead and do that. TA can vary with catalyst mass, and you expect to have a similar term here. But in this case, we won't have a negative sign because this heat transfer tends to increase the temperature of the cooling fluid. Right? We don't have a reaction term. There's no reaction occurring in our cooling fluid, but we do have a convection term. And in this case, it would just be the flow rate of the cooling fluid times the heat capacity for the cooling fluid. Okay, so the balance is very similar, but ends up being simpler in form. Okay, so you see that we're going to need, and this is more of a maybe a real world situation, that if we're going to design this reactor, we're going to need to know a lot of parameters that aren't just provided for us necessarily in a problem statement. We're going to need to figure out, okay, for a reactor of this type of geometry, what are reasonable heat transfer coefficients? What's a reasonable geometry so this A factor can potentially help us out? We need to know the density of the catalyst. We need to know all the heat capacities. We need to know the kinetics so that we have rate constants for the different rate expressions. We need to know all the enthalpy changes associated with the reactions. And so in the next part of this problem, we're going to use a numerical solver package, which is polymath, in order to do the solution. So that the problem doesn't take hours, I'm going to assume certain values for those parameters, but I think it's important to recognize that the values for those parameters sometimes are not just right at your fingertips and are things that you need to go determine and perhaps do an experiment to determine. Okay, but we've now set up the equations that we're going to need to plug in the polymath, along with plugging in some of the values of those constants in order to be able to simulate the performance of the reactor. And so we'll continue that in the next part of this problem.